Hi, my name is Ashwata. I'm a software engineer at Google. I am a hands-on software engineer involved in coding, mainly with Java and C++. I also mentor other engineers, and I'm involved in design and architecture decisions as well.
Hi, I'm Swati. I'm a software engineer at Google. In today's video, we will talk and demonstrate of how a Google engineer approaches an engineering problem. So I'll be giving a problem to Ashwata, and he'll talk us through the process of solving it. And towards the end, we'll also look at the positive aspects that he demonstrated to through the interview process. So Ashwata, the question that I'm going to give you today is this. Mm-hmm. I have a collection of numbers, and you have to take this collection and find pairs which sum up to the number that I give you.
Okay.
So for example, the collection of numbers is 1, 2, 3, 9, and you have to find the target 10. The pair of numbers which adds up to 10.
Okay.
And you could also have a target like 8, which mm-hmm. does not really exist over there. I have shared this problem as well in the Google Doc.
Okay.
And then we can go from there.
Okay. Let me ask some clarifying questions and we'll make some notes as we go. So in the second example that you gave me, where the target was 8, we don't have a pair of numbers in this array that we can that will add to 8. On the other hand, the first example is possible. So both of those can happen in this case. Okay. So how would these numbers be given to me? For example, will these fit into memory? Is this an array? How does this work?
Yes, it would be in memory and you can consider an array.
Okay. Okay. And how do we handle duplicate elements here? For example, if the sum is 8 and there were to be a 4 in the array, can I just add 4 to itself and make 8?
You wouldn't have a number repeating itself at the same index. However, there could be repeated numbers in the array.
Okay, so there may be 2 4s in the array, but I wouldn't be able to reuse a 4 that already exists in the array. Okay, can I assume that these are all integers? For example, can there be floating point numbers here? Can there be negative numbers?
There could be negative numbers and integers only, no floating point numbers.
Okay, that sounds good. Thank you. So when I think about this, the simplest possible solution here is just brute force. We can use 2 indices in the array, let's call them I and j. The I index would iterate through the whole array, and the j index would start at I plus 1 and then iterate through the rest of the array. That way we avoid any duplicates, as we discussed. And for each pair of elements, we would add them up, and we'll see if they add up to the target number that you give me. If they do, then we have found a pair. On the other hand, if they don't and we iterate through the whole array for both indices, we will know that there is no possible solution to this one. It's not very efficient, but it should work.
What's the complexity of the solution?
This would be quadratic.
Could we do better? Huh?
Okay, let's think about it. Better than quadratic. The elements are sorted, so we should be able to use that. As we iterate through the array, for example, the first element is 1 here, and let's say we're looking for a sum of 8. We can think of the complement of 1, which is 7. So we can search for 7 in this array. Since it's already sorted, we can do binary search. We go to the middle of the array. If that element is bigger than 7, we go left, otherwise we go right. So O of log n complexity for the search itself, and we'll repeat it for every element in the array. So that would be O of n log n for the whole solution.
Okay, this is still not the optimal solution. You could just still going linear. Could you think of something better?
Okay, let's think about that. I'm trying to see if we can bound this problem in some way. For example, in this example array, the last 2 elements would give me the biggest possible sum since the array is sorted. So that would be 3 plus 9 or 12. And the first 2 elements would give me the smallest sum because, again, those are the 2 smallest elements in the array. And everything in between is my range of values. So if I started with 2 indices, one pointing to the beginning of the array and one pointing to the end of the array, let's say we add them. So in this case, 1 plus 9 is 10. That's bigger than the sum that we are looking for. So we would move the right index towards the left to try and see if we can make the sum smaller. If that's not the case, and if my initial sum is bigger than the target, we would move our left index towards the right to see if we can make our sum bigger. And we would stop whenever we find a matching pair, or whenever the 2 indices essentially cross over each other, at which point we know that there is no solution. That would be a linear solution, I think.
Okay. Would you like to write down the problem?
Sure. We can try to code this up.
What's your language of choice?
Is C++ okay?
Okay, sure.
Cool. Sounds good. So I realize we haven't discussed what to return in this case. Should we just return a Boolean indicating if there is a solution or not? Or do we want to return the matching pair itself?
Do you see a problem in returning the matching pair?
Not really. It should be fairly easy. If we find a pair that matches, we would just return the pair. If we don't, we would have to return a Boolean. So we can think of creating some data structure that has a Boolean field indicating whether we found a matching pair or not, and then a matching pair. It's not very elegant, but it's doable.
Okay. Returning a Boolean would be fine.
Okay. So let's do that for now. I'll start coding. Okay. Let's call this has pair with sum, and the input is a vector okay for the array?
Yes, vector is good.
Okay. I'm going to call that data in here, and then there is an integer which is the sum that you're looking for. Okay. So I'm going to have two indices. Let's call one of them low, and that starts off as 0, and there is another one, let's call that high, which starts off at the right end of the array. Okay, so what I'm going to do is, as long as low is less than high, and that in fact that also takes care of the situation where we start with an empty vector, because what that would mean is low would be 0 and high would be -1, so we would never really enter this loop, so we don't have to worry about that edge case here. Okay, so while low is less than high, we add up the elements at those two indices. So we basically check if data of low plus data of high is equal to the sum that you gave me. And if it is, we can just return true right here. If not, we keep going. So we do need to adjust the low and high here. If the sum of these two elements is bigger than the target that you gave me, we'll have to decrement high. Otherwise, we'll have to increment low. So that's something that we'll have to do. To make this easier, I'm just going to declare a separate variable that stores that sum, so that I don't have to recalculate every time. Okay. So if that sum is less than the target that you gave me, if that sum is less than the target, then we need to try and make it bigger. So I'm going to increment my low. And by the time the while loop finishes, if we still haven't found a matching pair, we return false. This should do it.
Excellent. Now let me throw a wrench into the mix.
Ouch, okay.
Let's assume that the collection is not sorted.
Okay.
How would you go about in that?
Okay, so if the collection is not sorted, of course this will not work, but maybe we can just sort it. That's O of n log n. We can sort it initially and then just do the same thing here. That would work. It wouldn't be linear anymore, but it'd still be O of n log n.
Yeah.
Are we looking for anything faster?
Yeah, you could do it faster than n log n.
Okay, let's think about that. Let's go back to the initial idea that we had, mm-hmm, of iterating through the array, picking an element, and then looking for its complement. If it was sorted, we could have used binary search, but that's not possible here since the array is no longer sorted. We can do a linear search, but that will make the solution quadratic again. Let's see if we can do something better than that. Okay, so we'll stick with the complements idea. So I'm going to write down an example array here. So let's still use 1, 2, 3, 9, and we'll add one more. We'll call it 22. Okay, and let's say we're looking for a sum of 10 here. I start iterating through the array. The initial element is 1. Now I'm looking for a 7. If there is a way I know that I have seen a 7 before, then I'll be able to do it. So in other words, I think what we're looking for is a data structure where we can easily look up elements or their complements that we have seen before, and then go from there. And I think that would again be linear. So we should be able to do it linearly. A hash table might be a good data structure for this.
Okay, what would be the key of the hash table?
That's an interesting question. I guess we don't really need a hash table. We just want to keep track of what values we have seen here, not necessarily map keys to values. So we might get away with just a hash set. So in C++, I think that's an unordered set. As we are scanning through the values, for each value we see if we have seen its complement before from our set. If we haven't, we compute its complement and we add it to the set, and then we can keep going. It's a little tricky because, as we discussed earlier, we don't want to repeat elements from the same index. So we should take care that we don't add values to the set before we have already checked if its complement was in there. But that should be workable, and it would still be a linear solution for us.
Okay. How about the collection has million numbers?
So if we have millions of numbers, would they still fit in memory?
Probably not at this point.
Okay. So that would make it harder. So if we have a very large set of values, maybe we can still consider ranges of values. If the range of these values is bounded in some sense, we can take separate sets of values, as in break up the whole range into sub-ranges, and we can use different computers to compute this kind of hash set of complements for different ranges of values. So when we scan through the full set of values, we'd still need to know which computer to check in to find the complement. So it's tricky, but it's absolutely doable.
Do you want to code it at this point?
Sure. So in C++, for a hash set, we'll be using an unordered set of integers in this case. It should be called complements. I'm going to call it comp because I don't want to type this every time. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll iterate through the values in the input vector. In each case, we will check if we have already seen its complement. So we will say the syntax might be slightly off, but the basic idea should be here. So we are inserting complements. So we'll just check if in my set of complements we already have this value. And if we do, we can just return true. If not, we will compute its complement and essentially add it to our set. And I think it's just comp.add. And that should be it. If in case we don't find any matches, we'll return a false at the end. So that should work. It's the code itself is fairly simple, but let me trace it on an example to make sure that it works. So let's use this example array, 1, 2, 3, 4, 9, and 22. And let's say our target is 10. So initially, when we start this code, when we start the for loop that I'm highlighting here, obviously the unordered set is empty to start with. We look at the element 1, we try to find it in our set, we don't find it. So we add its complement to the set. So it will have 9 in it at that point. And then we look at the element 2, we see if that's in the complement set. It's not. So we add 2's complement as well, which is 8. We'll do the same thing with 3's complement and 4's complement as well, right? And then we get to the element 9. We check it in our set. It's already here. So at that point, we have found a matching pair. So we are done at this point. We'll return true. If we were looking for a different target, like 8, we would never find its complement in our set, so we'll essentially iterate through the whole array and we'll return false. So yes, I think this will work.
Okay, great job.
Thank you.
All right, so just to recap the interview that we just saw, there were a couple of things that you should be aware of while interviewing. One is to make sure that you understand the problem right and ask clarifying questions in order to do so. Ask for the question to be repeated if it helps, and also to be written down verbatim so that the question is clear. One of the questions that Ashweta asked was about the floating point integers, and that does affect the problem. So yes, it's a good one to be asked. The other thing that you could do is to always think out loud the solution. This helps the interviewer understand your thought process and also course correct when required. It's also good to ask questions which demonstrate your expertise and also helps to come closer to the solution faster. It's always good to brainstorm with your interviewer. After all, two minds at a problem is always better. One thing he did really well was to come up with a simpler solution and articulate it. The first solution is not going to be the best, and it's not the best for anyone. The interviewer will challenge you to do better, be more efficient, and the idea is to get to the right solution and then code it. Another great thing that he did really well and I would encourage is to test the solution. You can test it with some examples that the interviewer has already given, or come up with your own examples and test out the solution. Another good idea is to always test with the edge cases. Like in this case, we took the example of empty collections and tested it as an edge case. That gives you the confidence that your solution works for all different types of examples. Just like we saw in this interview, do the trade-off analysis of your choices proactively. The interview is time-bound, so manage your time well as you navigate the solution. Write clean and structured code, do not overcomplicate it. Leverage the latest features of the technical language for your advantage and stick to one language only throughout the code. Best is to do all of these proactively.